less of people interested in this.
In September of 2007, IBM was awarded the contract for the 2010 United States Census. The value of this contract is $89.5 million over the course of 9 years. This is the same company that undertook the 1890 U.S. Census, the same company that was contracted by Germany's Third Reich to undertake census operations and similar advanced people counting and registration technologies. IBM Germany not only headcounted the populace, but invented the racial census. They not only listed religious affiliation, but bloodline going back generations. This was Nazi data lust, not only to count the Jews and other non-compliant races, but to identify them. And this is the same company that was contracted by the Third Reich to lease the Whole Earth Machine to the Nazis from 1933 to 1945. So let's take a trip to the past and see where it all began. To find out what really happened, we thought it necessary to call upon an authority on the matter. New York Times best-selling author, Edwin Black.
Throughout the history of mankind, there has always been technology to enable mankind to better himself. And one of those technologies has been the ability to count and to keep track of people, of things, of motions, of places. But there are always companies willing to use that technology to create evil applications, or applications that could be used by evil people, genocidal people. There are always companies willing to take the money, and sometimes we don't know who they are. They're just out of view. They're working under different names. They're financing other companies. They're working through financial agreements. But the fact of the matter is, there is one company that considers itself the solutions company. And that company was willing to give Adolf Hitler the final solution. That company developed a partnership with Adolf Hitler to murder 6 million Jews. And that company, which tried to keep itself out of sight, has now come into the glare of history. And that company is the one we know. The concept of counting is older than Moses. It's as old as the first attempts at civilized society in Mesopotamia 5,000 years ago. But the fact is that counting did not become a scientific undertaking until IBM developed the information technology to count people, to track them, to quantify them, and therefore enabling societies to manage them. So how was it all done? Well, you could count on your hands and on your toes. But prior to the invention of the Hollerith punch card in the 1890s for the United States Census Bureau, there was no way to match an individual with cross-tabulated information about his environment, his characteristics, and his persona. And so, the information, any information, about individuals, about locations, about equipment, about all the data that we seek to clarify, all that information can be stored in the holes that are punched into rows and columns by an IBM punch card system. And then as that card passes through a reader, it detects the hole, reads the hole, and discovers the information laden within that punch card. And so, at the rate of 64,000 cards per hour, IBM could take a census and in one column punch the native tongue, let's say it was Polish, in a second column punch the religion, let's say it was Jewish. In a third column, they could punch the nationality, let's say it's Polish. In a fourth column, they could punch the profession, call it coin dealer. And the final column, they could punch the location called Berlin. And then at the rate of 64,000 cards per hour, the Nazis could determine, just like that, all the Jews of Polish ancestry who were coin dealers in the city of Berlin, identify them, and then subject them to the Nazi process. Because the same process that identified the Jews also tabulated their existence in clubs, in organizations, in professions, whether they were lawyers, whether they were educators, whether they were doctors. And that same process operated all the banks, all the savings and loans. We could identify their possessions, their assets, their bank accounts. And eventually, that system was able to take those Nazi-persecuted, IBM-persecuted individuals, quantify them, and suddenly move them from their homes into ghettoized homes, and then meter them out to gas chambers. Now let's, for example, look at these prisoner cards. Every prisoner had a card like this. It was a paper card, it was not a punch card. You might say that there's no way that IBM could have had anything to do with this. Well, if we look carefully at this punch card, we see a column here that says Hal Vermerk, it's abbreviated, Zuab, coming and going. And then we look here and we see that the word is verschlüsselt, which is German for keyed in, and Lochkarte geprüft, which means punch card verified, operator 6. So even though it's handwritten, people are punching this information in after it's handwritten. So we look at the coding here. Kripo is 2. This individual is coming in by virtue of Kripo, which is 2. And we compare that to the IBM code sheets, which shows Gestapo is 1, Kripo is 2. We look at where this person is going, and this person is going to Dachau, which is 3. We compare that to the IBM code sheets, and we see that Auschwitz is 1, Buchenwald is 2, and Dachau is 3. Dachau 3. Now, looking at this code sheet a little further to show you the power of these numbers, each of these individuals who were controlled by the Nazi IBM system were given numbers. In the case here is a Jehovah's Witness was a 2, a homosexual was a 3, a gypsy was a 12, and a Jew was an 8. Now let's look at the status. The status was A1 would be released, a 2 would be transferred, 3 would be death by natural causes, a 4 would be executed, 5 is suicide, 7 is escaped. But if you look at code 6, Sonderbehandlung, special treatment, that means gas chamber. That means that an IBM engineer had to organize a system to discriminate between the Jews and the gypsies and the homosexuals and others who were killed by execution, by starvation, or who were sent to the gas chamber, as the Jews were and many of the gypsies. And consequently, they printed up the special forms, they configured the equipment, they trained the Nazi personnel, and they serviced the personnel. And they sold them the punch cards. Without the punch cards, it's like rifles without bullets. This was information technology. And this was the gift that IBM bestowed upon Adolf Hitler. Now, everything was organized in terms of prisoner transfer, in terms of prisoner identification, in terms of prisoner skills, according to a so-called Hollerith number or IBM number. And every concentration camp had an IBM customer site called the Hollerith Department or the Hollerith section. It was called Hollerith Abteilung. This number ultimately became tattooed on some people's forearms. That's correct. The Auschwitz number began as an IBM number. Remember, the IBM Hollerith system, or punch card system, was not just a way of keeping track of people. It could keep track of warehouses, of inventory, of transportation, of trains, of individuals, of groups, of payments. They used it for banks. It made the railroads run on time. Anything that could be quantified was quantified with IBM punch cards, and they had a worldwide global monopoly. This appealed dynamically to the Nazis because they wanted to control everything. The Nazis wanted to see everything, be aware of everything, have a totalitarian state, which means a totalitarian understanding and control of everything in the state. And so the Nazis came up with the idea that every single object in society would have a so-called talking number or a descriptive number. There'd be a long series of numbers. There'd be a specific number for a wristwatch, and then a wristwatch that had a gold band as opposed to a leather band would have a different number, and one which would have a crystal face would have yet another number, and another which had a buckle to it or a clasp, those would have yet another number. And so you could get a perfect description of every product, of every substance, of every material, whether it was a cord of wood, whether it was a barrel of oil, or whether it was a trainload of Jews, based on this descriptive number. This evolved after the war into the barcode. In the first years after World War II, this concept of numbering everything in existence caused us to develop the barcode. And there were many formulations for the barcode, but eventually the IBM formulation for the barcode won out. And this was quite simply something that has become ubiquitous. We can find it on every tube of toothpaste. We can find it on every boxcar. We can find it on every truck. We can find it on every battery. We can find it everywhere as a product identification code. Enter RFID, radio frequency identification. This allows us to put a barcode in a tag on a sweater or a book.
Radio frequency identification is an automatic data capture technology. It exists in the radio frequency or RF portion of the electromagnetic spectrum, and it is used to uniquely identify products and objects. An RFID system consists of three components: an antenna and a transceiver, which are often combined into one reader, and a transponder. This is the tag being read. The antenna uses radio frequency waves to transmit a signal that activates the transponder. When activated, the tag transmits data back to the antenna. The data is then used to notify a programmable logic controller that an action should occur. The action could be as simple as raising an access gate or opening a toll booth, or as complicated as interfacing with a database to carry out a monetary transaction. RFID is coming into an increasing use in the world as an alternative to the barcode. The product embedded with an RFID tag is alive, and it communicates throughout its entire life cycle. The longevity of the RFID tag itself extends past the life of the product. Currently, there are no regulations protecting consumers from the abuses of this technology.
All the technologies which have the ability to advance mankind also have the ability to create a nightmare of repression. That which can warm us can also incinerate us. And this tracking capability is now being married to more than just tracking. It's being married to data mining. And so now, just as everybody has their own personal homepage on Amazon, you click it up, it knows who you are, it gives you recommended products based upon you and only you that are totally different from the next person who is loading up Amazon. They can now marry the information of an RFID tag with the individual, his likes, his dislikes, his problems in society, his threat to society, or can we say, his perceived threat to society? Or can we say there is a society that might perceive him as a threat, and they will use this RFID technology in the same way that they have used fingerprints and DNA and electronic surveillance and IBM Hollerith punch cards in the past for evil means and for evil ends. Now, what are we talking about? We're talking about this. This is an injectable RFID chip funded by IBM to a company that does not resemble IBM, so IBM can ultimately have complete access to and take over this technology. And right here, let's not drop this, this is the injectable chip that is planned for patients, for dogs, for pets.
In previous short films, we've investigated the use of implants in animals. We looked at the studies of Dr. Jose Delgado's research in the 1960s, where he implanted electrodes into the midbrain of a normally hostile bull. By means of a remote control, he used radio frequency to short-circuit the rage signals, stopping the bull before it reached the matador. We've also looked at a similar study on cats, where the opposite was accomplished. Rage signals were created via radio frequency, causing the cats to attack. In another piece, we looked at the tracking of animals and raised the question, whose pet are you? But today, we are going to focus on the puppeteer and look at who is controlling the strings and what they have planned for the marionettes. On the 6th of July, 2009, a portly Scott Silverman, the CEO of Verichip Corp., the company who owns the patent for the human implantable RFID chip, announced, Verichip Corporation supports legislation banning forced microchip implantation. And thus another agonizing act was completed in their clown, human implantable RFID rodeo show. Scott Silverman trumpeted, for years we as a company have enforced a strict privacy policy that starts with the voluntary use of our Verimed HealthLink patient identification system, which includes our implantable microchip, the Verichip. The primary application of our Verimed HealthLink patient identification system and the Verichip microchip is to identify high-risk patients and their medical records in an emergency or clinical situation. Scott Silverman continued, in general, we are supportive of legislation that prohibits forced implants. As long as legislators understand the primary application of Verichip and the benefits it can provide, we support, in fact, we started, the voluntary nature of implantable RFID. Why would Verichip Corp. issue such a press release, we ponder? Having been dogged by civil libertarians, privacy advocate groups, and being the butt of hacking security flaws, the death knell was sounded when Dr. Catherine Albrecht released her research article, Microchip, Induced Tumors in Laboratory Rodents and Dogs, a review of the literature. This article showcased a causal link between implanted radio frequency, RFID microchip transponders, and cancer. Sharing in this study was Dr. Robert Ben Ezra, the director of Cancer Biology Genetics Program of the Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center. He went on record to say, there's no way in the world, having read this information, that I would have one of those chips implanted in my skin or in one of my family members. Given the preliminary animal data, it looks to me that there's definitely cause for concern. Even to the average layperson, Verichip's devil's advocate position, taken with their press release supporting the microchipping legislation, sticks out like a sore thumb. It reeks of desperation, deceit, and sleight of hand as people from all corners of the globe reject the concept of human microchipping. The company has now attempted to eliminate their Achilles heel by distancing itself from mandatory human chipping. How grounded in truth is Scott Silverman's press release? Let us use semantics to testify to the press release's validity. The English dictionary breaks down voluntary to mean done, made, brought about, undertaken, etc., of one's own accord or by free choice. Acting or done without compulsion or obligation. Done by intention and not by accident. Having the power of willing or choosing. Verichip Corp. has presented itself to be the RFID implantable identification company who preserves and promotes civil liberties and free will. Fantastic news, you say, but let's keep in mind the word voluntary and let's go back to the science of semantics and look up the word Alzheimer's. a progressive form of pre-senile dementia that is similar to senile dementia, except that it usually starts in the 40s or 50s. First symptoms are impaired memory, which is followed by impaired thought and speech, and finally, complete helplessness. The open letter question to Verichip Corp is, how does an Alzheimer patient who has impaired thought and memory make a voluntary decision? The answer is self-evident. They can't. And thus the glaring obviousness is that Verichip Corp continues to embrace a smoke and mirrors campaign. By doing this, the lying stud pedigree of Verichip is maintained. On Wednesday, October the 13th, 2004, the FDA approved the Verichip RFID chip for human consumption. The radio frequency identification device contains a 16-digit patient verification number that is transmitted to a handheld radio scanner upon activation. How did Verichip get FDA approved? With a sprinkling of Tommy Magic Dust, of course. The FDA is overseen by the Department of Health and Human Services, which at the time of Verichip's approval was headed by Tommy Thompson. 2 weeks after the device's approval took effect on January 10, 2005, Thompson left his cabinet post and within 5 months was a board member of Verichip Corp and Applied Digital Solutions. Delving deeper into Verichip's blue closet, we find IBM, who of course denies any current involvement with Verichip, but as history shows, provided Applied Digital, Verichip, the necessary line of credit to continue operations, beginning their relationship in 1999. Go ahead and cue the Twilight Zone music, as now is where it gets a bit strange. Under the forbearance agreement announced on March 27, 2003 with IBM Credit, the behemoth information company IBM renegotiated with Applied Digital Solutions, Verichip, and settled the $95 million debt for a once-off payment of $30 million, having supposedly written off the $95 million obligation in 2002. This renegotiation smacks of a covert relationship, as IBM Credit could have liquidated more than 19 million Digital Angel shares to recoup its money. The smoking gun is also evident with the stock options IBM has of Verichip Corp, and the fact that Verichip Corporation's Verimed Medical Solutions is now integrated into a hospital demonstration area of the IBM Solutions Experience Lab. This closes the case that the world's largest information company is indeed involved with the human microchipping agenda. Imagine if IBM owned any patents relating to the tracking and tracing of people using RFID. Well, buckle up, because they do. On November 7th, 2002, IBM was awarded with the United States patent number 2002-016-5758, namely, for the identification and tracking of persons using RFID-tagged items. This patent includes a method and system for identifying and tracking persons using RFID-tagged items carried on the person, previous purchase records for each person who shops at a retail store are collected by POS terminals and stored in a transaction database. When a person carrying or wearing items having RFID tags enters the store or another designated area, an RFID tag scanner located therein scans the RFID tags on that person and reads the RFID tag information. The RFID tag information collected from the person is correlated with transaction records that are stored in the transaction database, according to known correlation algorithms. Based on the results of the correlation, the exact identity of the person or certain characteristics about that person can be determined. This information is used to monitor the movement of the person through the store or other designated areas. With over 2,000 IBM employees dedicated to working on RFID technology, from portal readers to specific applications enabling the tracking of pharmaceutical drugs, food, vehicles, hospital patients, students, and offering financial solutions for a new financial order, one can see the aspirations of IBM to dominate every sector, including the obvious. IBM's aspirations for a smarter planet extend to aerospace and defense, automotive, banking, chemicals and petroleum, consumer products. The list goes on and on. IBM claims in the marketing literature relating to RFID that the planet will be interconnected, intelligent. People want it. We can do it. How will IBM's interconnection be achieved? As RFID tags communicate to RFID readers, the readers can in turn communicate and transmit data over telephone or by internet to computers, and of course, satellites. On December 15, 2004, Orbcomm announced an application development agreement with Verichip to be its provider of satellite and telecommunication services for applications to be developed for use with the implantable RFID Verichip. The Orbcomm constellation consists of 29 low Earth orbiting communication satellites and focuses on M2M, global asset monitoring and messaging services. M2M translates to mean machine to machine, man to machine, machine to man, machine to mobile, and mobile to machine communications. Under the terms of the agreement, Verichip and Orbcomm will develop and market new military, security, and healthcare applications for use in the United States and around the world. Okay, we now have a patented human implantable microchip, a system that allows you to be tracked via satellite, RFID patents for tracking people, IBM controlling the census, financial transactions monitored and recorded. What else are we missing to put the web grid into place? Smart infrastructure, example, RFID sensors and portal readers. How will this be done? By petitioning government, as this example in Australia shows, for IBM to include smart technology and infrastructure spending. IBM's Australian arm, Glenn Borham, stated that the Australian government should embed computer chips and wireless devices in the nation's infrastructure, and that this smart technology was a way of beating the global financial crisis. Mr. Borham says this plan can be implemented if the government works with businesses to create pilot projects in Australia, where we can set up a town, we can set up a small community. He goes on to preach that putting smart devices into cars could solve a lot of traffic problems. If we were able to look at a network of understanding where cars were on a road, that, filtering into computers, could analyze data and do predictions, so that they could say, well, if there's a breakdown here, it will have this sort of flow and effect. We could then actually get information to people in real time. The question Glenn Borham fails to answer is, what right does IBM have to propose to put a spy chip into Australian citizens' vehicles without their consultation and consent? Moving along, what else does IBM propose? Let's add a global identity system into the mix. Cal Slimp, the vice president and global leader for security and privacy, stated that an international standards backed up by a UN body are needed to clear up the international identity verification mess. IBM Secure Identity Solutions offer organizations a wide range of advanced identity verification solutions. Capabilities include the use of smart cards, biometrics, RFID, identity management, and security systems. Slimp goes on to say, IBM is trying to create a mosaic for what countries want as good identity management. Wider international cooperation is needed to establish a common language and standards. It is interesting to find out that the common language for exchanging user access information is also known as Federated IAM. This is an interesting choice of terminology, at the very least. Cal Slimp went on to more grandiose statements to say, what's missing right now is a trusted third party to authenticate trustworthiness. That's rich. IBM has denied their involvement with the Hitler regime. They've denied selling census data to the Nazis, and they now self-appoint their company to be the world identity sentinel. Pass and double pass. As we stand on the cusp of the Orwellian Dark Age, we need to realize that Verichip is not static technology. When the Verichip was first released, it was a crude RFID solution that posed no threat to civil liberties and humanity. But as the evolution of the Verichip continues, some red flags have been raised. Scott Silverman goes on to gloat, as we continue to build on our partnership with receptors, which started with the development of the glucose-sensing RFID implantable microchip, for diabetics to have the ability to measure glucose levels in their body through an external scanner. We are moving beyond patient identification to sensors that can detect and identify illnesses, viruses such as swine flu and other emerging diseases. This is an exciting next step for the future of our healthcare division. This is a concerning development in the Verichip product evolution. First, it opens the Titanic diabetic market. And second, the uptake by this sector could be high in providing Verichip the necessary cash flow to penetrate new markets. As we have already documented, the shady and questionable FDA approval Verichip has obtained. This makes the swine flu pathogen sensor microchip an alarming progression. Sweetheart deals could be struck with the World Health Organization and governments worldwide for Verichip to become the swine flu solution when the media hysteria promotes the pandemic. Keep in mind, Verichip has gone on record to say, that the implantable microchip could be worth a whopping $100 billion in revenue, comprising of 26 vertical markets. That sort of revenue by any company's standards is stupendous and would require a great part of the world's population to be chipped. If you thought the unholy alliance of IBM and Verichip could not get any worse, it does. Guess which company manufactures the Verichip? A little company known as Raytheon. This is the fifth largest defense contractor in the world and the world's largest producer of guided missiles, best known for its Tomahawk missile. And looking over in Seoul, Korea, we find IBM's ubiquitous computing lab, the Sensor and Actuator RFID Solution Center. The Seoul Center specializes in sensor and actuator RFID enablement, working with clients to deploy IBM Sensor and Actuator RFID solutions. The center's capabilities include sensors that can detect patterns by using multiple streams of sensor data for automatic analysis of human behavior and habits, including who you are, where you are, what you are doing, and predicting your next action through data correlation. This is what we have to look forward to. We will deal with this in more depth in our next film, including why IBM is building the global brain and tackling the modern day eugenics movement, transhumanism. But imagine for now an Internet of Things, where every object from cans of Coke to jumbo jets to human beings are uniquely identified via their EPC, electronic product code. And remember the tattoo that began as an IBM number? Well, now they want to put the tattoo under your skin. A unique number that is the barcode on steroids. An interconnected, ubiquitous computing, electro-meshed, real-time web where billions of objects are tracked simultaneously, all through an evolving internet protocol and an ambient intelligence environment. An environment that reacts to you, as it is aware of your movements, through sensors, portals, wired and wireless networks. These objects, humans, are tracked from birth with history, data files created on them as they progress through their entire period of existence. A goldfish in a fishbowl has more rights than we do in this controlled system that we have explored.
When you ask IBM, as many people have, why they did it, the information company says, we have no information. We've lost it all. They should take a cue from their Nazi clients, apologize for what they've done, and move on. But by stonewalling history, they have linked themselves inexorably to the crimes of their Nazi customers committed decades ago. Will IBM ever be brought to justice? The answer is no. The fact is that many people have sued IBM around the world. They were never called to account during the Holocaust, never called to account after the Holocaust, and they will not be called to account today. They are indeed bigger than nations, bigger than genocides, bigger than the justice system itself. It was IBM that both calculated the weather for the Normandy invasion, for the United States and Allied forces, and the strength of the German defenses for the German high command. And remember who organized all of the evidence for the Nuremberg trials. That company was called IBM. Now, maybe you're willing to vouch for the American government. Are you willing to vouch for the Chinese government? Are you willing to vouch for the Saudi government? Are you willing to vouch for the North Korean government? For the Thai government? Are you willing to entrust this enormous technology without restriction? Without the type of restriction that is guaranteed to keep us alive, because this is the final frontier of human tracking. And the most vulnerable will be targeted first. The people with the least power, with the least money, with the most physical disabilities, with the most racially vulnerable aspects. We have a potential here to see the Hitler program at warp speed.
Today perhaps marks the first day you have been introduced to the human implantable technology. Perhaps you have been aware of it, but pushed it quietly to the background. Rest assured, this is a collective war we are fighting. And although it is not being fought with guns and ammunition, It is being waged on your mind, and your free will is at stake. So put down your credit cards and remotes, form rank, and dig deep with us. Petition your local members in government. Network. Share. Use the resources on the website, and let's march forward as a collective, united group that can and will stop this encroaching agenda. You are not an animal that needs to be branded. You are not a product that needs to be identified. You are not a number. Send a strong and united message to Verichip, IBM, Raytheon, and all the other companies that wish to enslave you and your family that we the people will not be chipped. This isn't only a privacy issue. This is a human rights issue. To IBM, Verichip, Raytheon, we state loudly and clearly, we will not let history repeat itself. We the people will not be chipped.
Because this is the final frontier of human tracking.
Hold the soul went out to sow, bearing precious seed in his hand, hoping on hope that he might see it grow. Knowing that the harvest might well come before the bloom, he runs on his way, there's no time to be going slow. Hurry, take what you've got, and do with it what you can. The good God in heaven needs a sower in the land. Hold the fell by the wayside. Some of it fell among thorns. Some of it fell upon stony ground. These would never bring forth fruit, but they would not believe that when the sower was gone, the reaper would be coming around. Hurry, take what you've got and do with it what you can. Good God in heaven needs a sower in the land. Lift up your eyes. The fields are already white. Can't you feel the oncoming night? Behold, the soul went out to sow, bearing precious seed in his hand, hoping on hope that he might see it grow. Knowing that the harvest might well the bloom. He runs on his way, there's no time to be going slow. Hurry, take what you got, do with it what you can. The good God in heaven needs a sower in the land. Hurry, take what you got.